Hello, everybody. We would like to invite you to introduce yourself in the chat if you would like to, and feel free to turn on your video for this session. You're not required or obligated in any way, but if you'd like, it could facilitate a bit more of a dialogue among us. Hi, oh, good to see everybody. Welcome, welcome. Feel free to introduce yourself again in the chat so we know who's here with us today. And we'll just wait one more minute for people to trickle in, and then I think we can get started. Welcome, welcome. Nice to see everyone. So for those who just joined, feel free to turn on your video if you would like, no obligation. And without further ado, then I'd like us to get started. I'll be your facilitator for this breakout room. My name is Erin Coughlin de Paris. I'm an associate professor at Tufts University. I work on climate extremes and disasters. And I'll be working with Leni Wollenberg, who of course needs no introduction, as the co-facilitator here today. And we'll be talking about climate information advisories and early warning systems. So the goal of this session is to hear from all of you to identify priority systems and leverage points for transformative change, right? What would this look like? What can transformative change look like within climate information advisories and early warning systems? With the goal, of course, of advancing both adaptation and mitigation to climate change, and focusing on inclusion of underrepresented populations, gender equality and social inclusion, and of course, the enabling environment. We heard a bit about this in the earlier session, and I know several people put comments in the chat about underrepresented populations, so it would be great to expand on that and have more of a deep dive into this.
I don't know, I've been at this
discussion here today. So, before we begin, I'll ask Lauren Alamgan from Tetra Tech to explain a bit about how we're going to collaborate. There are so many of us, of course, we won't all be able to speak at once. And so we have this Jamboard technology that we can use to collaborate. So over to you, Lauren.
Thank you, Erin. Hi, everyone. I'm Lauren Alamgan. I'm a data and analytics associate with Tetra Tech, and I'll be helping facilitate this kind of in the background. If the person from We and Goliath is on, I believe that we have an instruction screen that you need to share. You can go ahead and share that at any time. We're going to be using Jamboard. And essentially, when the screen does come up, you're going to see different sticky notes and different kind of sections. We have priority systems, leverage points, and then recommended references, which the facilitators are kind of lead the discussion through each of these. It's fairly simple to click on the sticky notes. You double click to kind of write your own thoughts. If you could also write your name and your organization so that we can kind of track you down after, that would be great. Let's see, just see if we can get the screen up here because the instruction, there we go. All right, hopefully everybody can see the screen. All right, and then also, I believe the person from We and Goliath, I believe you're gonna put the link to the Jamboard so that everybody can access it in the chat. All right, so the link is in the chat. If everybody could click on that, and then just let us know if you have any issues in the chat box. All right, go ahead, Leni and Erin, take it away.
Great, thank you. So to repeat for those who just joined, our goal right now is to hear from all of you on what are the sort of transformational opportunities within climate information advisories and early warning systems. So what are priority leverage points for transformative change, considering adaptation and mitigation, and in particular, inclusion of underrepresented populations, gender equity and equality, and the enabling environment. So feel free to, exactly, I see some of you already typing in the Jamboard, which would be great. Move around the sticky notes and input your ideas typing. But then you may also raise your hand or simply unmute and kick off the, oh yeah, it looks like we're in a climate finance Jamboard. Hang on. Here's our Jamboard. Thanks to Yeah, thanks to all of you for noticing that. Do you seem to be in the correct one now? Could I get a affirmative? Yes. Okay, great. Perfect. All right. And so if you want to start typing into the Jamboard, that would be perfect. And also feel free to raise your hand and kick us off with ideas. What would you say would be priority leverage points when it comes to climate information and early warning? Yes, please go ahead, Shaukat Ejim.
Yes, hello. Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. Yes, I am from Bangladesh and I am the country director for practical action. Yeah, so we do have programs around under the climate resilience, especially on early warning advisories, as well as we are also working with here with the Ministry of Environment, Disaster Management on some apps programming for loss and damage assessment. So while we do this, the issues we found, of course, the point of your inclusivity and especially more focus, if we talk about the women, you know, bringing in and you think about them, that they also get the technology. You know, in Bangladesh, apparently you can think that, okay, the huge coverage of mobile network and things like that. And if you send those advisories or want to promote, we may think that, okay, it is reaching out everyone, but no, still those mobile and those devices are controlled by men, or even their timing, those are not accessible by female. So we, you know, went there and have research and data analysis, because with our advisories, it is agromed advisory. So it is related to climate change early warning, but at the same time, it is related with agricultural informations, you know. So timing is an issue. Then you think types of questions and interest, these things really gives you some leverage point how you can create. But at the same time, we train both men and women so that women can also be seen as an agent for early warning system and networking, and that encourages others. So I can stop here. I know
Great. So, thank you very much. 2 points of clarification for those who are something funny just happened to our Jamboard.
Should still be able to access it though via the the whole thing disappeared, right?
Okay, well, I was going to say I'll save my comment for the Jamboard for when we retrieve our text in the Jamboard. Aha, there it is. What I was going to suggest about the Jamboard is that those of you who are writing your names, please put your comment first and then your name second. So, you know, whatever it is that you're suggesting and then your name. And so just following up on that excellent point about reaching people with early warnings and advisories, I think that's great. And I'd love to just provoke others to say, well, are there major leverage points or successes or suggestions you have for how we could better reach people who tend not to receive information that they need? Over to you, George Asari.
Thank you very much. You already mentioned my name, so let me go straight to my point. We've been developing climate smart advisories for farmers in West Africa. I am a project manager at Technicia. And one of the lessons we've learned over the years is that farmers take decisions without considering accurate weather forecast. Because they don't have accurate weather forecast, they use traditional means to predict the weather. For example, they apply fertilizer, and within the next 2 hours, rainfall or runoff washes it away, and they lose the effects of this fertilizer. So we are able to tell them what the weather would be like on a daily basis and even on an hourly basis so that they don't lose out on some of these important things. But over the years, working on this, the key thing is that most of these farmers are not literate. So if you send them the information and the language is heavy, they are not able to understand. So we have to use very simple language, and most of them don't have smartphones. So we have to use SMS to send the messages and keep their texts very few and straight to the point so that they can be able to understand and use it. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Would anyone like to build on this and suggest leverage points for supporting this improved connectivity or better reaching people, places where you've seen this done well?
Yeah, sorry, I haven't raised my hand, sorry. This is Gordon.
Go for it.
My name is Gordon Nkwe. I'm also from Ghana and I work with Isoko. I know Isoko is a household name, so I will not talk much about Isoko, but I just want to add a little to what just said. We notice in our work in trying to reach farmers or trying to bring them to the last mile on what information we want to give them to make them get either early warning or weather advice or climate smart agriculture. One key thing is illiteracy in our part of the world. And what we have now noticed is it's best to reach them through voice. So most of our things that we are doing, we have been able to convert most of them to the local language, and we try to reach them through voice. We have currently built a farmer helpline with a call center, which speaks 15 local languages at the call center. So I make sure that any information that we need to get to the farmer, we are able to get it to them on time, and then in the language that they can understand and make use of it better. Thank you.
That's great. Thank you for that example. Over to Barry Pittenger.
Great. Thank you very much. So I'm Barry Pittenger here from Purdue University. So I work with a program called Scientific Animation Without Borders, and this is exactly what we do. And we take expert knowledge on a given topic where there's a gap in a given system, and then create animated materials that are very accurate around that. So how do you reduce use of firewood? How do you deal with things in very pragmatic terms that can reduce negative environmental impacts but have positive outcomes for those that are using the materials? And then place those into local languages through a network approach. So we're up to about 280 languages. And then that content is then used by other groups in their scaling efforts. And in often cases, it's specifically for low literate learners that speak diverse languages. And then we work with country partners who are using many different forms of approaches to their deployment, but including WhatsApp networks that will get it out to somebody who has a device that can accept that. And then that device becomes approach where they can work with people who are offline. So we see that our thoughts are really, there's a tremendous need for us to identify what are going to be the important gaps in these systems, and what are the research for development innovations that are already exist from CGIAR centers, NARS programs, universities, other organizations, where there's strong evidence that that intervention can have a positive outcome in people's lives, and then look towards how can we develop scaling pathways. So I think identifying those gaps like is critical, and where the solutions already exist in research for development and interventions. I think it's very important. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. Go ahead.
Thank you for the introduction. I hope you can hear me.
We can now.
Hello. The platform information available. The key leveraging point or low-hanging option is, you see, even when you have this information, the key challenge is how to make this forecast helpful to farmers and letting them have it in an understanding that translates to recommendations for them. And you see, that is one area that I think whatever recommendations coming from this body will help to address. Of course, there are different organizations doing different things, but still, it's an area that requires a lot more innovation and wide participation. Because one, the liability of this forecast are variable, and also now how do you translate those forecasts into the different recommendation domains under which the farmers are working? In Nigeria, for example, what we have tried to do is see how we can translate them into smaller domains, but it's still not effective because a lot more of it needs to be outscaled. Thank you.
Great points. Thank you very much. Absolutely. Back to, can we try you again, Elizabeth Asimwe? Yeah, Zoom is showing now a yellow box around you, which seems like it should be getting audio, but I don't hear anything, unfortunately. Just thinking outside the box then, as maybe a last prompt, we have maybe 2 or 3 more minutes left for discussion. priority systems and leverage points. Oh, perfect. If you can type in the chat, that would be great. And welcome to anyone else who would like to do that or type into the Jamboard. You know, there are several large climate-related disasters happening in the world today. I'm sure you could think of many of them, right? From what's happening in Somalia with drought to flooding in Pakistan. What would have been helpful in these cases? I mean, thinking really concretely, what kind of priority systems or leverage points would you see if you think back at your own experience of recent disasters locally or internationally? And if you don't feel comfortable speaking out loud, please do answer directly on these sticky notes. I'm reading through them and they look excellent. Lini, would you like to comment or say anything?
Yeah, I can just observe a couple of patterns that I'm seeing in the Jamboard, but I could also leave that to you. What do you prefer, Erin?
No, that would be great.
Yeah, okay. So we see a pattern in needing to build on existing knowledge and have participatory processes as one point. Another is leveraging existing structures of agricultural extension and advisories and linking information delivery to those. Perhaps a third point would be, the other points don't cluster as neatly, infrastructure, investing in infrastructure. And a fourth point that I thought was really important was how to coordinate all of this and the role of donors in coordination, both on the demand and the supply side. Those are the major points that I'm seeing.
And coordination for sure in terms of advisories is critical, right? Conflicting advisories is the worst, for sure.
There are also a couple of points on the data itself. So building on historical data, getting more precise early warning systems.
Perfect. So I'm happy to report these things back in the main session. So what we've said about reaching everyone, methods to, you know, improve connectivity and really reach everybody who needs to be reached with pragmatic and creative communications, that was great. What information is being communicated is also relevant here. So, you know, these participatory processes to understand what people need and how to make that work and ensure coordination. Is there anything we've missed? Anything people would like to add? Yeah, go ahead, Edmund Totten.
Yes, thank you, Emily. And I think it's important to highlight also here the value of indigenous and local knowledge, mainly in African countries, where weather infrastructure is not available everywhere. If we can value this kind of knowledge, I think I put it in one of the post-it. It's important to see this bricolage can help to strengthen the robustness and the accuracy of climate information in African contexts.
That's great. Any thoughts on what that looks like in practice, right? So how would you recommend people really do that well? I feel like it's a widely expressed ambition and not everyone engages very well in that space.
Well, I know in some countries, and especially in Kenya, I saw also example in Burkina Faso, where we call them rainmakers, traditional leaders involved in kind of project for interpreting climate information with their knowledge together with climate scientists. And then they share now the final products. It's make a kind of a bricolage. You know, it's not only something coming from science, but it's coming from both of knowledge. So that's quite interesting. I know it can be time consuming. It require also a lot of energy to drive this process. But I think the value of this kind of process is that we build really on what people need What are the aspirations and the expectations? And also it value the local knowledge, and they see themselves as part of, as a kind of actors of this process. So they drive the process themselves. It's not only, that's why I put it, it's not only designing climate information for people, but it turns into to designing climate information with people, and that make a difference.
Great. I think that's excellent and a very clear relationship to what people have been writing in the Jamboard as well. Rehana Noor, I think you might get the last word. We have about 2 minutes remaining. Over to you. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you so much for giving me the floor. At BRAC in Bangladesh, we are working to create a support center who can actually, disseminate this early warning information, messages to the farmers, because we have tried out different apps in several times and many web portal, but it didn't come out very good at the end because the farmers are not digitally literate, and I don't know, they have some hesitations to use this app, especially if you look at the farmers' age. Most of the farmers are the middle age, and they are not aware of how to deal with smartphones, and smartphones and internet connectivity are not available in many remote places. So for me, I think I would suggest if we can, government and the other NGOs can collaborate to each other and create a support center where farmers can come and the field staff can visit to their places and disseminate those knowledge individually and with the focus group discussion. That would be a great source of information dissemination when it comes to the early warning system for the farmers. So thank you.
That's great. Excellent points. And so it seems like a lot of the priority systems that people are thinking about involve communication systems as a major priority for investment, in addition to sort of the other theme we were hearing about collaborative participatory processes to co-define what information gets pushed out through these communication systems, of course. I think we might get kicked out in about a second or two to the, oh, okay. No, so here's the moment we were supposed to X out of this box. Do not leave the breakout room. And we actually have 100 seconds to keep going forward. Jim Hansen, I see you put your video on. Would you like to add a comment? Or was that by accident? Sorry to put you on the spot.
I've been inputting my ideas in the sticky notes. There's a lot of existing knowledge, but unfortunately it needs to be fragmented. So I think there's a real need and opportunity, and it could be transformative if we get rid of silos, build on existing knowledge, somehow deal with the fragmentation problem, and balance the supply side bias that's still prevalent in many countries. Thank you.
Great. Supply side bias is a great term. So in terms of leverage points, really trying to move away from that. Excellent. Well, I think that is going to pretty much wrap up our session. I'll report back to the group what we've said about communication systems as major priority systems, and then leverage points in terms of these participatory processes. Leni, anything else you'd like to add as we wrap up?
I think the data point is also important about modeling and building on historical data. And then Ana Maria put in about pests and diseases, making sure that these systems also extend to different kinds of systems.
Great. I think that's perfect. So looking beyond just weather forecasts, but at impact forecasts relating to agriculture in general. That's great. All right. Well, thank you everyone for your participation and for your active contributions in the Jamboard. This will be passed on directly to the authors of the study, and we really appreciate your thoughts.